Thank Danny very much for his thought-provoking talk. Today we have two discussants. I'll introduce them separately. The first is Professor Larry Brown. He's the Niers Bush Professor and Professor of Statistics since 1994 at Wharton. His PhD was from Cornell. He was a full professor at Rutgers and Cornell until going to Wharton. Throughout his career, he's won many awards and honors, including being a member of the National Academy of Arts and Sciences, member of the National Academy of Sciences, fellow of ASA and IMS, elected member of ISI, winner of the CR and B. Rao Prize, Wilkes Award of the American Statistical Association. He was a Wald lecturer and was president of IMS in 1992 and 93. He has served on and chaired many NRC committees and has been involved with matters related to the decennial census in many ways, ranging from congressional testimony on NRC panels, also including his own research on estimation of the components of census errors. He chaired the 2000 National Research Council panel to evaluate the Census Bureau research program and is currently chair of CNSTAT, the Committee on National Statistics. His own theoretical research includes classic works on, among many other topics, exponential families, decision theory, integral estimation for binomial proportions, and more recently on theory for valid post-selection inference. Dr. Brown.
I really just want to make a relatively few remarks about what Danny said, in part to emphasize some of the major points that I think are important that he's made. We all agree we live in a big data world. I don't like the term big data, so I try always to find some other way of expressing it. One way is that we're really saturated by data. It's all around us. We contribute to it as we get measured in our various activities, and we're exposed to the measurements from everyone else. What's certainly true is that there are thus many more sources of data and many more types of data than we're accustomed to, or than the world has been accustomed to, and many of them we don't know how to understand what they really mean and the process that that generates them. And the world continues to change in the direction of more and more saturation of data. Well, in one way of looking at what Danny said is that he's trying to confront and corral this saturation from the point of view of official statistics. And so there's what I could consider as Danny's list of big problems and leading to big headaches. I guess I wanted to talk mention a few of them. For example, the issue of linkage, which Danny discussed in the context of Israel, is, I think, broader and more difficult in the U.S. context. Danny has the advantage of having his finger hovering over much of the official lists in Israel, whereas the official lists in the United States are that might be linked, even the official links are widely scattered among agencies in the federal statistical situation and elsewhere in government. And even linking them is a serious question. But more, perhaps more looking forward, not to downplay that issue, which would be and is currently being worked on as a big step forward, but moving even further into the data-saturated world means realizing that sources of data will not be constrained to within the official system in any way, but will be and must be come from outside as well and be synthesized somehow. So that I think official statistical agencies may be, need to transition to some extent to from a role of the gatherers of the data to a role of the, well, we're here in the agriculture building, so to the role of, what should I say, growers of what do you say in agriculture? All sorts of things and you put them together. Anyway, you get the idea. And so let me move on. Danny actually two lists. And I put the what I thought of was the bigger list first and the more specific list second. But I agree with essentially all of both of the lists. Here's a list of tough challenges. Some of these have to do with, some of these Danny has some solutions or potential directions for solutions for. I'll talk a little bit about that. At one level, many of the issues are not new, but what is new is the range, intensity, and the pace of the problems or progress, lack of progress, the pace of the problems. And it's the pace that's new, not the existence of sources outside of official statistics, not the fact that there is some big data around or data that feels big. What feels big 10 years ago now feels small. What feels big today may feel small 10 years from now. So I wanted to take a particular example to try and illustrate what's on my mind when I say that the issues are not new. It's not a perfect example. It has some imperfections, but if you pick up the imperfections, I think you'll see what the point of the example is. And it actually illustrates a problem that I think Danny's list of headaches, he's got one more headache. That doesn't really encompass. So here's an area that I know a little bit about in terms of statistical, official statistics or semi-official statistics, which is the measurement of house prices. This is an important issue in the U.S. economy, along with many others, but you know that house price indices and house prices are important. So in the U.S., it turns out that the major index of house prices is not an official statistic. It's the kind of statistic that that national accounts look at, so it is looked at by official agencies, but it is not, the major measurement is not an official statistic. It's the Standard and Poor's Case-Shiller Index. So it's something produced on the private side of the economy. It's based on a big and timely data collection. It's not an electronic collection in the very modern sense. It's not the kind of traffic data collection that Amy was talking about, but it is a big data set collected in real time with quite a bit of accuracy. It's not a census. The data is processed. Data on sales and sale prices is processed, organized, and it's further processed through a mathematical algorithm. So what you see is not a simple average by any means. So it's not just an accounting of how many sales at what price. It's prepared for monthly release, so it comes out timely. There are other indices that come out even more frequently, but there is a daily index produced by somebody else. It's by metropolitan area. That's not exactly a small area, but it's smaller than national or statewide. There is some small area analysis, type of analysis that goes into it, hidden behind the curtain. There is another house price index. So here's an area where there is an official statistic issued by the Census Bureau on a regular basis, competing with a private measure. Privately produced measure. The Census Bureau is based on a traditional type of sample survey. It's a survey, but, and here's the major but, it's a survey of new home prices. Whereas the Standard and Poor Index is based on a survey of actual sale prices of all homes, including new homes, but not limited to them. And the output produced here by the Census Bureau is akin to a usual sample mean with some adjustments and standard errors. So in the latter part of the 20th century, the two indices told a similar story. There's the case Shiller Index in red and the Census Index in blue, pegged to the year 2000 just for convenience, because I want to move forward from there as well. And you see they both traveled up pretty upwardly, pretty much together. There's a little difference there that you can notice, but they catch up and they follow each other. You could say the official statistic and the other statistic are measuring the same thing. But more recently, something strange happened from a statistical perspective and from an economic perspective. The Case-Shiller Index and the Census Index tell qualitatively a little bit similar, but rather different stories about what happened in the period from shortly after 2000 up until now. The Case-Shiller Index went very peaked and very steeply down. And that's a much more useful story, turned out to be. What is the right story for the economic picture in that era, from the housing perspective, but also from the national perspective. And so it turns out that there is a big data measure and a small data measure, an unofficial measure and an official measure. And the real problem is that they're measuring different things and that they haven't been synthesized together. And I think as official statistics moves into an era of data saturation and use of many different types of resources, these issues that are sort of a little bit apparent here of what is being measured, how is it being measured, and what does it mean will be highly relevant. This issue doesn't exactly fit any of the categories in Danny's list, and that's what I wanted to point out, that there's something else going on, that another issue that we'll need to be contending with. It's not a coverage or selection bias, though it has something to do with coverage and selection. It's not an issue of computation and analysis, though I do want to point out that the Case-Shiller index involves some moderately sophisticated computation. I've written a paper saying they could have done that computation better. But that's not the central issue. It's kind of a mode effect, but it isn't a mode effect in the classical sense. Okay. In this case, to close this discussion, in this case, the big or big-ish, it felt big back in 1980 when it was first implemented, but it now feels kind of small, a million houses a year or something like that. Anyway, here big or big-ish data wins over conventional survey data. That isn't necessarily the case in other examples. There are examples, I think, where the official traditionally produced statistics produced the right picture, but we need to, official statistics and statisticians and agencies need to think about where the right data can be gathered. And it's certainly true that new sources of data lead to new styles and types of data, and these may be differently suited to desired uses. I'm going to go very quickly now. I probably used up about all of my time. I hope I didn't, because I only have two slides left. Danny then goes on and talks about some challenging ideas for new statistical methodologies. The biggest leap, in a way, is the willingness to invest effort and invest in terms of producing statistics, in principle, through such types of mathematical models. And I think that's important. He talked about use for internet panels, for mode effects, and small area estimates in future censuses. Each of these areas, in each of these areas, he's talked about things that I sort of know about. I've looked at corners of each of these problems, and so it is very tempting, was very tempting for me to try and leap in and talk about the technical slides he produced. Some of the things he said I don't quite understand, but they're all challenging and important attempts, I think. But I'm going to skip that effort. I think it would be hard on this stage in this amount of time to try and carry this out. So instead, what I can conclude with is to sort of dip my toe, which is in the dabble in the same upon that Danny did. And Danny, in terms of academic training, the first part of Danny's discussion of academic training, I think, is rather pessimistic. And I used to be pessimistic in the same way. I think I don't feel as pessimistic as I used to. And actually, Danny's last slide explains why. There are some good programs related to official statistics. There are other things going on that Danny didn't mention, like the census research collaboratives, which have engaged high-quality academic researchers and students in training at a number of institutions in the United States. But there are other trends as well that official statistics or government agencies should pay attention to as being important for them. There was a little discussion just before this session with about the issue of so-called data analytics. That's another buzzword. It's not clear what data analytics means. At Wharton, there's an initiative in data analytics to produce programs for master's and possibly PhD level in data analytics. But whatever it means, it involves a lot of the types of measurement that official agencies produce, a lot of sample surveys and similar activities, not from the government side particularly, but from the private side, but those are the kinds of activities and the kinds of questions and the kinds of enterprise that show that the subject is very much alive. The subjects that need to be looked at are very much alive. I happen to be at a university with a fine, small group in observational data. And as Danny has pointed out, observational data methodologies will be a core of the future processing of the kinds of data that, that's likely to be of use. And there's quite a number of very active researchers, for example, in that area. So I'm less pessimistic than Danny might have sounded, so long as the official statistics agencies are cognizant of all of the opportunities in this kind of world. I should probably stop here. I'm not sure what John is going to say. I think he's also going to talk about this academic issue, and he may or may not be, he may be on either side of it, I don't know. Anyway, I'll turn the floor over.